some bad news.
I knew it. I love when he does that.
Wrestling has more than one royal family.
Tribal chief around here. Yeah, you see me, the tribal chief. That's right.
On time. But let me go ahead and tell you.
Shut your bitch ass up.
Look how far we've come. You're still here. This is us. These my confessions. Still going strong. Yeah, man. Let it go.
Up our home, want the best, leave us alone.
Sometimes when you're by yourself,
you think about what we've been through.
Sometimes when you're by yourself,
you think I'm just the same old you, yeah.
I hear you talk,
but listen to me.
I see you walk.
Oh, baby, don't leave. I'll do what a man don't do just to make you see.
Girl, I know a man ain't supposed to cry. But I think I might, cause love is on the line, yeah. Cause baby, if I lose you, I might die. I'm trying hard to find it, but I think I might, cry. Oh, I might cry.
No date. Hold up, baby, just wait. I was drinking, yeah, so what? Can a nigga have a drink at the club? We talked and we laughed, but nothing else happened, cause
sometimes when you're by yourself,
you think about what we've been through.
Sometimes when you're by yourself,
you think I'm just the same old dude, yeah.
I hear you talk,
but listen to me.
I see you.
To make you see.
Girl, I know a man ain't supposed to cry, but I think I might, cause love is on the line, yeah.
Baby, if I lose you, I might die. I'm trying hard to find it, but I think I might.
About to break me down to tears.
Oh, I know it's hard for you to see that I've changed for you and me. And even if I got to cry, that's what it's gonna be.
Girl, I know a man ain't supposed to cry.
Oh, but I think I might.
Oh, yeah.
Cause love is on the line. If I lose you,
I'm sorry,
baby, I'm sorry.
greetings and salutations, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to episode 428 of the Hoots Podcast here on this Friday, August 30th. Rise and shine. I'm recording this bad boy literally at 6:50 in the morning. I just got done with my walk, and I'm ready to pop out a new show for you guys. It's going to be a little abbreviated edition of the podcast this week. We'll definitely get to the preview and predictions for Bash in Berlin and No Mercy, which I'll be covering this weekend for WrestlingHeadlines.com, so make sure to check out my work there. It's in the results section, pretty easy to find. So I'll be doing that. These next 5 days are going to be very, very busy for me. I got SmackDown tonight. I have Bash in Berlin tomorrow afternoon. Starts at noon here in Chicago, 1 p.m. on the East Coast. And if you live anywhere else, figure it out for yourself, as the old saying goes. Also, Sunday, I have the NXT PLE No Mercy, which is taking place in Denver. That'll be a Sunday night pay-per-view. Then we got Raw on Monday for Labor Day. Then back on the grind again Tuesday for NXT Fallout from No Mercy. So your boy is going to be busy these next couple days. It'll be a nice little ROI type of week. But hey, man, as the saying goes, the grind and struggle is real. But I'm in good spirits. Hope everybody's doing well this week. I have a couple little things I wanted to mention here for the monologue this week. I've been doing a little bit of a rewatch of How I Met Your Mother on Netflix. I don't get too much time to myself, especially with my new work schedule, working at my grandpa's guitar shop. By the way, if you are interested in guitars or even some antique collectibles, it's also a pawn shop in its own way. If you live in the Chicagoland area, come check us out at Tommy's Guitars and Trading Post, 2548 West Chicago Avenue. Come check us out. We have a lot of our listings and stuff on eBay and Facebook Marketplace. So anything pops up your eye, go check it out, or check us out on Tommy'sGuitars.com. This new work schedule has been an adjustment period for me, to say the least. But I'm having a good time. I feel like I probably have lost like 20 pounds since I've been working at the shop, man. I've been moving and busting my ass, especially this week, man. I'm feeling it. Like, for those who don't know, like, not that I'm not getting enough sleep, I am. I at least try to get at least 6.5 hours, and I've been trying to go to bed earlier. Like, usually for me, it's either like 11:30 or past midnight I'll go to bed, but I usually get up now at 5 o'clock in the morning, and then, go into straight to, get ready for work. But as I was saying, you know, I don't have much time to myself now these weeks, at least downtime, unless it's like a Sunday or Monday. Those are my days off, technically, from the shop. And in that downtime, I use it to watch Netflix, or, you know, maybe I'll play my guitar or something like that. But I've been rewatching How I Met Your Mother, and they dropped it on Netflix, I think, a month and a half ago or something like that. And I've been watching it nonstop, and, you know, binge-watching seasons, and certain different things pop out to you and stuff like that. And I think I did an episode on How I Met Your Mother on this podcast before. It's in the archives. Make sure, if you're a first-time listener or watcher of the Hoots Podcast, make sure to like this video and subscribe to our channel. We appreciate the support. By the way, if you want to follow me at Twitter, you can, at the Hoots Podcast. I am Joshie Lopez. You can follow me on Instagram at Josh Lopez Music. And more importantly, the best way to help out the Hoots Podcast is following the show on Spotify. It's free of charge. You don't have to put, you don't have to pay anything. Hell, you can listen to the show for a minute. any help in analytics that we can get from Spotify that really help expand the reach of the show. That's all I ask for you guys. So follow the podcast on Spotify. So anyways, certain things pop out to you when you, like, rewatch the show and you have different ideas. You know, I did an episode theme about How I Met Your Mother, about, like, a concept of me, like, how I found myself, which was a little interesting play on How I Met Your Mother, right? And, I would say outside of Friends, How I Met Your Mother has probably had the most profound impact on my life, at least from an entertainment and life point of view. And I know there's always going to be the running debate about how the series should have concluded and stuff like that, and maybe the way it ended left a sour taste in people's mouth. I've always said that at least it would be good to have a little bit more of a context if we had just one more season, but you know, sometimes context and substance is lost. If you think of where all those actors were at that time of their careers, you know, Robin Colby Smulders was already becoming a breakout star in these Avengers movies and stuff, and Jason Segel, Marshall, was, you know, getting ready to explode on his own end. You know, he had a big hit with Forgetting Sarah Marshall, and then he was getting ready to explode with that Puppets movie, and he really dedicated himself to that. If I'm not mistaken, I think Jason Segel made an appearance on Monday Night Raw or something like that to promote the movie. I could be wrong, but it's starting to sound familiar. Anyways, I'm rewatching the show, and I always hear the debates. Oh, is the ending of the show, did it make sense? Blah 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 blah. Anybody that tells you that are openly telling you that they didn't get the purpose of the show. If you really think about it, through the nine seasons of the show, ask yourself this question: if the concept was only solely based on the mother, why during the clips where older Ted would talk to the kids, why wouldn't you say, hey kids, go get ready, your mom needs you to bring in the groceries? Why is it just a reflection time with him and his kids if the mother was still alive? I knew where it was going when the first season ended, and I got the purpose of the show. And yeah, there's a little bit of a Friends template you want to attach to it and stuff like that. But at the end of the day, yes, Ted is talking to his kids and it's a story about How I Met Your Mother. But it's also a reflection of his life. And, you know, just calling it like it is, sometimes the mother of your children is not the love of your life. Sometimes the mother of your children is not your soulmate. And it could be a shitty thing to say that, but it's also real life. And that's one of the things I really admired about How I Met Your Mother, because it really hit on core principles and stuff that's real. You know, and I know there was a little things that we had to suspend our disbelief and stuff like that, but like, just when it came to like the serious moments and the serious dialogue on the show, it really touched us, a real hard-hitting things that a lot of people don't really pay attention to or want to acknowledge, at least, you know. And I knew all along that this story was about Ted and Robin. Hell, I'm like right on season 9 right now, and every little thing, and you have that moment where Robin's looking for the locket at the carousel, and Ted helps her dig it out, and then they have the argument about destiny and the universe and everything in between, and then they had the episode on season 9 about platonic relationships, and then even before Barney and Robin's wedding, that conversation late at night where Robin and Ted are looking for Barney because he got so drunk that he disappeared. And they're out in the sand, and Ted is telling Robin that he's going to Chicago, right? If you can't tell the writing on the wall of where things were going, also going into that morning of the wedding where Robin was found out that Ted found the locket for her, it was always Ted. I think what gets lost in sauce is that the chemistry and the entertainment side of Barney and Robin mesh so well that people lose sight of the fact that that relationship was on borrowed time. They were never going to go the full distance because they are too similar to each other. And I'm not saying that there wasn't a real connection with Robin and Barney, but really, the crux of it was Ted and Robin. And this life teaches you to trust timing. As Robin told Ted at Punchy's wedding from season 7, I think, right? Episode 1, where they're at the wedding. And it Ted's on a whole speech about, you know, I'm starting to lose hope. I'm starting to lose faith and stuff like that. And she's like, you gotta trust timing. And he's, one piece of advice here, and it's a great thing about How I Met Your Mother. There's a quote that Robin said on the show that said, you need two things when it comes to love. Chemistry and timing. But timing is a bitch. Timing will show, but the journey along the way will not be easy. And I think that could apply to anybody's love life. Whether you are divorced, whether you've been somebody that's been cheated on multiple times. If you find yourself in a position where you start questioning your worth, or if you'll ever find that person for you, always believe in three things. God leading you to that person and guiding you to find yourself in that process. Two, chemistry with that person. And three, timing. That also could apply back to God, because he'll show you the way. So I every time I rewatch the show, I'm like, I don't know. It's kind of similar, and I can use a wrestling tie into this. Is like, oh, why? The arguments that you have about the ending of How I Met Your Mother is kind of the same silly arguments that you would see on Twitter when it comes to like a wrestling angle and stuff like that. And it's like, you can really tell that people are not really paying attention to shows if they act as they do. So I thought that popped out to me, so I wanted to use that analogy for you guys. Outside of that, I'm doing pretty good, guys. I know that we have a holiday weekend coming up on Monday with Labor Day, so hope you guys enjoy your 3-day weekends. I have a very busy weekend, so I'm having the opposite of a Labor Day weekend. I'm actually working. So, yeah, man, I'll be busy these next couple of days, and then, you know, football season is right around the corner. I'm sure sometime for next week's episode we'll do, like, a full, like, preview and stuff and my thoughts of where the Bears are going to go this season. I'm very excited for the season, so we'll get into that. Plus, you know, I know Christmas is around the corner. I've been really, really just, like, putting that work, both with the articles and the shops, so I've really just been putting my money to the side and stuff like that. But if anybody wants to know or asks me what I want for Christmas this year, is to have, I wouldn't say a week. I don't think a week would be enough. I want to, after Christmas, I want to have 10 days to myself in Florida. I want a little longer vacation to wrap up the year and start the new year. Right before I move. Anybody ask me what gifts I want or anything like that, if anybody can make it possible for me to have 10 days to myself in Florida, I would deeply appreciate it. That's all I want. I want to spend the end of 2024 and starting 2025 in Florida right before I move. That's what I want as a gift. That's all I want. I think it would be a great way to cap off what has been a very, very, very rewarding year. Personally, spiritually, mentally, everything in between. This year has been very, very touching, and it's been, I haven't said there hasn't been any bad parts of it. You know, while living life, you know, it's not always rainbows and butterflies, but I would definitely say, and yes, it's very coincidence that it's my 30th year here on this planet, but I am, I'm very grateful to see the progress that I've made within myself, not only with taking care of my health, but also how I see myself, and, 2024 has been really a really good year for me. I would say 2024 has definitely been a good bounce back year for me on a lot of different levels, and I'm just in a really good place in my heart, mentally, spiritually, emotionally, and I just appreciate you all. You guys have no idea. Even for the fact, for those who still continue to listen to the show week in and week out, it means a lot to me. So, I want to wrap up this year and start the new year right. And I want to be back in Florida for 10 days. That's all I want for Christmas this year. That's all I want. Anyways, we're going to put a ribbon and a bow on this week's monologue. When we come back, we'll get into this week in WWE, and we'll go straight into predictions for Bash in Berlin and No Mercy. I'm not going to waste your time with recaps for Raw and SmackDown. Let's get straight into the pay-per-views. Then I'll answer your questions in this week's edition of the Back Porch Q&A session, all right here on episode 428 of the Hoots Podcast. Be right back. Welcome back, everybody, to the Hoots Podcast. I'm talking about what happened this week in WWE. We're going to go straight into our previews and predictions for No Mercy and Bash in Berlin taking place this weekend. Like I mentioned earlier in the show, please don't forget to check out my play-by-play transcripts of these shows on the results section of WrestlingHeadlines.com. All that being said, also, if you want to see my older past transcripts, my website is still up there if you still want to check it out for yourself, ProWrestlingTranscriptions.com. Okay, let's do this in the style of Excalibur. Also in the segment, I'll go give you a rundown of the matches that stood out the most to me from television this week as well. It's a little combo platter for you guys. So here we go. Coming July this Saturday from the Uber Arena in Berlin, Germany. It's the inaugural WWE Bash in Berlin. Here's your matches. First, for the WWE Women's Tag Team Championship, it's the Unholy Union, Alba Fire, and Isla Dawn taking on Bianca Belair and Jay Cargill. Next, a match made official a couple weeks ago on Monday Night Raw as the Best in the World, CM Punk, takes on the Scottish Warrior, Drew McIntyre. Next, a match made a mixed tag team match with a lot of grudge in it. We have the Terror Twins, Damian Priest, and Rhea Ripley taking on the Judgment Day's Dirty Dominic Mysterio and the Women's World Champion, Liv Morgan. Next, a match made official on a couple weeks ago on SmackDown for the Undisputed WWE Championship. It's Cody Rhodes taking on Kevin Owens. Next, in the main event for the World Heavyweight Championship, it's the Ring General Gunther taking on the Viper, Randy Orton. More matches to be announced, make sure to follow Triple H on Twitter at Triple H. Make sure you get all your tickets right now at WWE.com/tickets. That's WWE.com/tickets. Ching! I'll tell you what, guys. I'm very pumped for this pay-per-view. I'm excited for it. There's some matches here from a transcription point of view that I'm excited to check out. I think Punk mentioned it that the strap match will be in a different version where you're touching all four corners. So that'll be a little different of a challenge to type that out. You know, some gimmick type of matches are easier to do than others. But when you're doing, like, let's say, like, a last man standing match compared to, like, a no-holds-bar match, there are two different ways to transcribe those type of matches, what I'm trying to say. Kind of give you, like, a behind the fourth wall type of comment there. There's a different process from typing out those type of matches, but I'm very excited for it. Obviously, this has been the feud of the year, or rivalry, or whatever you call it, and we'll see. I think something will definitely happen here where we do get the third match at Bad Blood. But that's the question. What is that match? Is it something where McIntyre tries to cheat in his way to get all four quarters? But that's the thing, too. Since the bracelet has been such an integral part of this storyline, that's definitely going to play a factor in this match. And I know on paper you'd be like, oh, CM Punk has come back to the company and he's lost two matches over a stupid bracelet. But it's not. It's the principle behind the bracelet, and you know, when you look at it for what it is, you know, like, it's good storytelling. It just is. So, of course, I'm biased. Of course, I'm loving everything I'm seeing from my favorite wrestler being back on my TV screen. But, you know, anything could go here with this match. Punk can win, and McIntyre just beats him up after the match. I can see Drew winning, too, where he plays so much mind games that he gets the best of Punk. And, you know, McIntyre steals another victory. But we have to see, you know, Punk got the best of McIntyre during his recovery process. Now, McIntyre got the big victory at SummerSlam. Is this victory more definitive? Is it something where, is it just the bracelet too much for Punk to keep his eye on the prize? You know, I'm just very curious to see how they lay out that match. I really am. At least from a transcription point of view, I'm very curious to see how they lay out that match. I have no doubt that the physicality will be there. I'm sure the psychology obviously will be there. Of course, that shouldn't be a question. But I'm very, very curious to see how they go about just laying out the match and what it looks like by the end of it. But I'm very excited. I'm going to go with a safe bet here because I like to go with my gut more than my heart sometimes when it comes to these wrestling shows, because sometimes you put too much emotion into it and you try to project sometimes with your fantasy booking as to what you would do compared to what should happen and what's probably going to happen. I want to be realistic with you guys and I don't want to lead you guys astray. So if you ask me who I think is going to win this match, I think it's going to be Drew McIntyre, and then Punk gets to find a laugh. You know, Punk may not win all the battles, but he'll win the war at the end of the day. So I'm going to go with Drew McIntyre, but I would not be surprised to see a Punk wins as well. I do have Bianca Belair and Jade Cargill beating Isla Dawn and Alba Fire to become the Women's Tag Team Champions. Unless this is a moment here where somebody slips on a banana peel, Unholy Union gets to retain the victory, and then Bianca Belair turns at Jade Cargill. I know the predictable option would be to say that Jade would turn on Bianca, but I think the writing has been on the wall for a while, and I think this would be the good time to do it because you kind of lay the foundations there, you know, and this could be like a physical attack where Bianca lays out Jade Cargill for a while, like write her off of TV for a while, like maybe even a couple months. Hell, have her come back after the new year. Like, seriously, like get Jade out of the TV. Have Bianca brag about it for a couple months, establish her new heel persona. And if you want to do Bianca and Jade at WrestleMania, I definitely can see that happening. I really could. But I think maybe they want to give them one more title reign before that turn happens. I just go with my safe guess and say that Bianca and Jade wins. But there is also a possibility that Alba and Isla retain and, you know, Bianca just snaps. Be on the lookout for that. I'm going to tell you right now, be on the lookout for that. And it'd be the interesting, like, little plot twist because, you know, Bianca could go back to being a heel. Maybe she has a feud with Bayley now that Bayley's probably going to be out of the title picture for now. Charlotte Flair would be back. So, hey, they pulled the trigger before on heel turns on these international PLEs. Why not now? Nobody would see it coming. You heard it here first on the Hoots Podcast. Make sure you give me some credit on X. That would help out a lot. What other matches we got here on this card? Yes, the mixed tag team match. Shenanigans galore. This is not a scenario of what could go wrong, will go wrong, because this is not AEW and we don't have Aubrey Edwards and Rick Knox, the Dead Corps ref, officiating this match. This one is going to be crazy. It's going to be very entertaining. I think the crowd in Berlin are going to eat this up. I'm not too familiar with the German crowds, like as far as like their energy levels. Obviously, I probably have covered over 100 shows for the UK over the years. So I know what to expect from, like, you know, we had the Paris crowd for Backlash. We had Cardiff, Wales for Clash of the Castle a couple of years ago. They have all these different places. You know, just think about it in context. I'm very curious to see, like, how this Berlin crowd compares to the other ones that we've seen so far for these international PLEs. Berlin, you got to bring the A game. You got to bring the A game. So we'll see what happens there. But as far as this match is concerned, I think they're going to kill it. I think that Dominic is such a good heel that he doesn't have to do too much in the ring. And it's just like he's going to be such an agitator. He's going to be a pest. He's going to... Michael Cole is probably going to call him a piece of shit during this match. I bet you any money that Michael Cole will call him a piece of shit during the match. I honestly believe that Dominic and Liv are going to beat Damian Priest and Rhea Ripley. I don't see a scenario where Damian and Rhea just beat them straight like nothing, like garbage. Like, I'm not saying that they can't win the match, but I think that Liv and Dominic are going to win. And I think Finn Balor is going to play a big role in that. So, and if anything, maybe it's something where Dominic gets a big victory in a pinfall on Priest. That could add some, you know, bragging rights, I guess, in this rivalry. I think Dominic and Liv are going to win the mixed tag team match. All right, let's talk about the two big world title matches we have on deck. First, let's go with the Undisputed WWE Championship with Cody Rhodes and Kevin Owens. I saw a little trailer. I think this was on Raw this week where I think Corey Graves had a sit-down interview with Cody and Kevin, and that's going to be airing on that Countdown to Berlin pre-show. By the way, I kind of like the new... I've really been enjoying the new way that WWE has been going about, like, these pre-shows and post-show coverage of the pay-per-views. It has a little different vibe to it than it was when Vince was running the show. I kind of like the new presentation of it, is what I'm trying to say. I know they're having a press event today before SmackDown, so I won't get to see that, but we'll see. Maybe I'll get to watch it after I'm done with SmackDown tonight. I have to go to the shop today, so it is what it is. Let me say this, though. I'm very excited for this match. I am. I think, obviously, you got two friends in there. A lot of questions up there. Well, is this a scenario where Kevin turns on Cody and they just have a program with each other? Or is this just a one-off and is this a spirit of competition? I'm curious as anybody else is about where this is going to go, because I can see a scenario where Cody just beats Kevin and then the Bloodline attacks both of them after the match. Because Solo, I think he did say this last week after SmackDown, he's like, it doesn't matter who wins at Bash in Berlin because I got next. So if it's going to be Cody and Solo in Atlanta, you know where the writing on the wall is on that end. But that's the thing too. I've been thinking about this a lot because I know Bad Blood is, I know a lot of people are excited for that PLE. So am I. I think Atlanta's a great place to have it. I don't know if anybody has mentioned this yet, but if anybody has, let me know. Maybe it's just me. I have a feeling not only Roman Reigns is going to be in Atlanta, I think The Rock is going to pop out in Atlanta. I know a lot of people expect Roman to cost Solo the championship, but the twist here is that The Rock is going to come out and attack Cody. I think Rock is going to be popping out in Atlanta. I think he's going to be at Bad Blood. Something is telling me that it's too easy to go right there into it. Unless the slow game here is that they want to have Cody and Rock at the Royal Rumble. And then you can do Cody and Randy at WrestleMania. Or you can do Cody and Randy after this pay-per-view going through the fall. Then you can do Cody and The Rock at WrestleMania. But I think part of me feels that The Rock is going to show up in Atlanta and beat up Cody in his hometown. Just throwing it out there. But I do think Cody retains, and this is definitely will set up a match with Cody and Solo at Bad Blood. So that's how that's where I see that going. Then we got the main event with Gunther and Randy Orton for the World Heavyweight Championship. I loved their match at King and Queen of the Ring in Saudi Arabia back in May. It was a lot of fun to transcribe that match. Was it May or June? Something like that. It was in between. But, yeah, I'm very excited for it. These two are going to put on a mat clinic. It's going to be a lot of fun. It's probably going to be even more physical than their first match. So, I know Randy Orton's going to be in it for the long run. And this is going to be a fun, fun match. It's going to be a different pace. It's going to be a little different than your standard world title matches in 2024 from all promotions. I'm not knocking other promotions, but it's true. some of these world title matches in other promotions, like a fucking Sonic the Hedgehog match where they don't let anything breathe and they're kicking out every other finishing move on God's green earth. By the way, I'm sorry if you're hearing any ruckus in the background. It's not me. There's they're doing like a lot of construction stuff and work stuff around my house now because, like I told you guys before, my Wello and Wella are basically moving soon. So they're doing a lot of construction, a lot of different yard work and stuff like that in the house. So just want to let you guys know. If you hear any banging and stuff like that in the background, they're just working in the back outside. So no problems. I think Gunther will retain here. I have no doubts about that. I think Gunther will retain and beat Randy Orton. I have no problem with that. It should be a fun match. I'm looking forward to it. And it's just it's one of those shows where you get to sit back and relax and enjoy the show for what it is. So I'm very excited for Gunther and Randy Orton fighting each other at Bash in Berlin. So that is on Saturday. Then we go to Sunday for No Mercy for NXT. Let's do this in the spirit of Excalibur. Let me take a swig of water before I do this. All right, here we go. Coming to you live on Sunday from the Ball Arena in Denver, Colorado. It's the NXT's No Mercy. Here's your matches. First, Roxanne Perez takes on Jada Parker for the NXT Women's Championship. Next, let me restart that. Coming to you live from the Ball Arena, it's NXT No Mercy. Here's your matches. First, for the NXT Women's Championship, it's Roxanne Perez taking on Jada Parker. And a match made official this week on NXT television. Chase University's Andre Chase and Rich Holland takes on Nathan Frazier and Axiom. A match made official a couple weeks ago on TV as Kalani Jordan puts her NXT Women's North American Championship on the line against Wendy Chu. Next, a match made official also this past week on television. It's Alba Femi put his NXT North American Championship on the line against the Don of NXT, Tony D'Angelo. Next, a grudge match features Wesley and Zachary Wentz of TNA. And our main event for the NXT Championship, it's Ethan Payne taking on Joe Henry. And Trick Williams will be the special guest referee. We got two bangers. I'm not going to lie. This is going to be a fun pay-per-view weekend. I am not going to lie. I mean, Chase U and Nathan Frazier and Axiom had a crazy-ass tag team title match a couple weeks ago on TV. I know Wesley and Zachary Wentz probably will want to steal the show. You got Roxanne Perez and Jada Parker. Jada Parker has definitely been one of the performers that I've been very high on. Especially since I've been covering NXT more weekly over the past year. It's pretty cool. I'm not going to lie. This card is going to be very good. Alba Femi and Tony D'Angelo. You got the main event, obviously, with Ethan Page, Joe Henry. You got a little bit of everything. I think No Mercy is a really good appetizer of what we can see for this NXT brand as it heads into the CW era. So I'm very excited for it, actually, to be honest with you guys. I think we're in for a pretty fun show coming up on Sunday. So let me breeze through these predictions really fast for you guys. I have Roxanne Perez beating Jada Parker. I have Kalani Jordan retaining over Wendy Chu. Obafemi will beat Tony D'Angelo. I have Chase Yu retaining over Frazier and Axiom. And Axiom will turn on... Nathan Frazier will turn on Axiom. I have Wesley beating Zachary Wentz. And I got Ethan Page beating Joe Hendry. Pete Dunne will get involved. I think another referee will be inserted here, which will make the three count for Ethan Page to retain here. So, I know Trick Williams will be the special guest referee, but Trick will be laid out by Pete Dunne during the match, and I think that allows Ethan Page to steal a victory from Joe Hendry. Or, maybe this is a scenario, and I've seen this out there, maybe this is a scenario where Josh Alexander slides in and costs Joe Hendry the championship, because I think they have a feud with each other in TNA. I haven't obviously been paying attention to TNA since I stopped covering this show when I was doing with all that budget cut nonsense and the furlough crap last year. But hey, you want to showcase Josh Alexander and helping out his former tag team partner, go for it. I don't mind it. So we'll see what happens. But I'm very excited. Those are my preview predictions for Bash in Berlin and NXT. Really quick, let me give you some of the matches that really stood out to me on TV this week. Gorillas and Destiny against Street Profits from SmackDown. LA Knight and Santos Escobar for the U.S. Championship was very good. Hell, even that triple threat match, the six-woman tag team match with Bianca Belair, Naomi, and Jake Hargill against Blair Davenport and Unholy Union, that was a fun match too. So those are the ones that stood out to me on SmackDown. When it comes to Raw, obviously Bronson Reed and Braun Strowman was fucking phenomenal. Bronson Reed is the new winner of, capitalizing and maximizing your TV time, so I want to give a shout out to them. Judgment Day and LWO, the 8-man tag to kick off the show on Monday, I thought it was a lot of fun, a very, very good match, so give props to the Judgment Day there, getting that victory. Out of the two triple threat matches that we saw in this number one contenders tournament that they're doing for the IC title, my favorite one was The Miz, Xavier Woods, and Pete Dunne. I thought that match was very good. Pete Dunne got the win with the bitter end on that one. And then Uncle Howdy and Chad Gable, I thought was a solid main event as well. From NXT this week, again, props to the ladies of Metaphor and Fatal Influence. That was the first match, so I thought those ladies delivered very, very well. What are matches from NXT stood out to me? The Family against North Quarter Cash Crew, I thought it was all right. It was a mixed person, six-person tag team match. It was nice to see Rosemary on my TV screen. I was not expecting her to be popping up in TNA, not TNA, but NXT. I thought that was pretty cool to see her there. And then Joe Coffey and Javon Evans, I thought was very good from NXT on Tuesday too. So those are the matches that stood out the most to me. I'd love to hear from you guys. What stood out the most for you, good, bad, and different for this week television? Make sure to comment down below and let me know what your predictions are for both Bash in Berlin and No Mercy coming up on Saturday and Sunday. Like I said, make sure you follow my play-by-play coverage of both shows on WrestlingHeadlines.com and ProWrestlingTranscriptions.com. When we come back, we'll wrap up the show with the signature segment of the show, that is the Back Porch Q&A session, right here on episode 428 of the Hoots Podcast. We'll be right back. Alright guys, welcome back. What we're starting to do here on the podcast this week as we get to the Back Porch Q&A session, as we do each and every single week here on the Hoots Podcast. As always, if you have a question for the Back Porch Q&A session, all you have to do is hit me up on Twitter at the Hoots Podcast or the Hoots Podcast at gmail.com. Let's do it, folks. Let's throw up the X. X Team Zaletta 24X on Twitter as we give a shout out to good brother Chris Zaletta on the Twitter machine. Let's see what he has for us this week. What a boost. Here's some questions for the Q&A this week. When it's all said and done, Russell Wilson, Hall of Famer or not? I think there's so much good body of work in his early part of his career that he'll make it just off of that. I know these past 4 or 5 seasons haven't been the greatest for Russell Wilson, but optics-wise and all that crap, but I still think that Russell Wilson will probably be a Hall of Famer. I don't have a question about that. In the next few years, do you think WWE will have multiple PCs in certain locations? That's a good question. I do. I think that they might have one in Vegas. It only makes sense to do it, obviously, since they have the partnership with UFC and the whole TKO stuff. I definitely can see that. I see one in Vegas. I can see one back in London again if they decide to bring back NXT UK. I would love to have NXT UK back to cover that show again, but we'll see what happens. But yes, I definitely see more PC places, and essentially it gives more opportunities to hire people, or maybe you can shuffle out some of the master crew that they got down there in Winter Park, Florida. We'll see what happens. Some predictions for the NFL this season. I think the Cowboys are going to miss the playoffs. I'll start off with that. I think that Mike McCarthy will definitely get fired this season. I'm not buying the Green Bay Packers at all this season. I think they are going to miss the playoffs this year. They just had a big loss the other day with A.J. Dillon going out for the season. I saw that. I know I'm not a Packers fan, obviously, but you never want to see good players, you know, get injured like that. So that's a big loss for them. I'm not too sure yet if I'm buying the hype with the Houston Texans, and I'm sorry to say that to my buddy Mike Rubio. I need to see consistency. And I don't want to say that this was just an outlier performance from CJ Stroud, because he is a good quarterback and they had a lot of good acquisitions this offseason. But we see this before, where a team gets super hyped over off-season acquisitions and then they kind of flop. Kind of like that super team that they have with the Eagles. What was it, like 2011 or 2012, something like that? Oh my god, the Eagles are so stacked and they didn't even make the playoffs that year. who should Mariah May's first challenger be? Gosh, I don't know. I have no idea, man. That's a good question. Anna Jay, Serena Deeb. It's so hard to pick, man. I'm not really sure. I'm not too tapped into the AEW women's division at this moment. So, you could throw in Thunder Rosa into the mix. Maybe Deonna Purrazzo, if she's still there. I'm not sure. That's a hard question. I'll just go with Thunder Rosa as a safe bet for now. Does Strowman eventually join the White Six, and could this past Monday possibly be the start to it? That's a good question. I'll say yes and yes to both. I see where you're going with that, Chris. I can definitely see that happening for sure. Who does Bryan Danielson lose the title to? Well, it's sure as hell better not be fucking Jack Perry. I don't know what the fuck that was. If to wrap up the show on Wednesday in Champaign. By God. What are we doing? Bryan Danielson against two-faced dipshit? Like, that's the best that you got to follow off your biggest show of the year? Come on, guys. Oh, man. I think it'd probably be either Swerve Strickland or maybe Will Ospreay or something like that. Hell, maybe Darby Allin is the one that puts Bryan Danielson away. Who knows? We'll see. Those are the three that stand out to the top of my head. Is Ospreay, Swerve, and probably Darby Allin. I mean, I guess you could throw MJF if you want to piss people off, but I don't know. We'll see. Did you catch AEW title match from All In? I did not. I went grocery shopping. I did watch at least the first, first 3 hours of the pay-per-view. And then I went out to do groceries. So I missed the coffin match, and I missed the Bryan Danielson and Swerve match. I only saw the highlights of the finish of the main event, but I did not watch the match itself. And I haven't yet watched the Britt Baker and Mercedes Moné match either. Who's more likely to debut at No Mercy, Julia or Stephanie Van Kerr? I'm going to say Julia. I don't know what's going on with Stephanie's visa problems and stuff like that. I'm going to say for now it's going to be Julia that makes her debut at No Mercy. That's my prediction. What matches are you looking forward to the most for Bash in Berlin and No Mercy? Well, for Berlin, I'm really excited for Randy Orton and Gunther. Also, CM Punk and Drew McIntyre, of course. Storyline-wise, obviously, the Terrence Wins Judgment Day should be a lot of fun. That whole card on Saturday should be awesome. Now, for the No Mercy show, I'm stuck between either the tag team title match or the main event with Ethan Page and Joan Hendry. It'll be those two, and then I'll throw in Oba Femi and Tony D'Angelo for the Styles Clash, if you will. So those are the ones that I'm looking forward to. But on that note, I want to give Chris a shout out. Thanks, brother, as always, for participating in this segment. As always, if you guys would like to participate in the Back Porch Q&A session, all you have to do is hit me up at Twitter at the Hoots Podcast or the Hoots Podcast at gmail.com. On that note, make sure to follow me on Twitter at the Hoots Podcast. Hit me up on Instagram at Josh Lopez Music. Don't forget to check out my transcripts of Bash in Berlin and No Mercy in the results section of WrestlingHeadlines.com. Let me know. Hit me up in the comments section, guys. What matches are you looking forward to on Saturday and Sunday, and what's your predictions for both PLEs? And if there's anything else in wrestling that you want to get off your chest, vent, or whatever, let me know in the comment section. I'd love to hear from you guys. Don't forget to subscribe to the podcast. We're on the road to 1,000 subscribers on YouTube. It'd be cool to get one of those cool play plaques in my studio. And also, don't forget, most importantly, follow the podcast on Spotify. It's free of charge. I'm not charging you anything to listen to this podcast, and I appreciate the support from each and every single one of you. Don't forget, folks, be the authentic product that is yourself, and remember, nobody dictates the pace of your life but yourself and the man upstairs. I love you guys. Have a wonderful weekend. I hope you guys enjoy Bash in Berlin and No Mercy. Have a wonderful Labor Day weekend. And we'll be here next week to recap it all and get you ready for the 2024-2025 NFL season right here on the Hoots Podcast on the road to 500 continues. Yeats.
Bye-bye, bitch.